to Burvey Parish Church. Welcome to those who are here as guests and visitors, and those who are watching and listening along. You're all very welcome as we worship God today. For those who don't know me, my name is Andrew, and let me welcome you here. This morning, a couple of announcements and notices for us. The first is that I'm on holiday for a week, starting on Tuesday. So Tuesday the 23rd, from Tuesday 23rd for a week. And so if you need any things, you can either just email me and I'll get it when I get back, or you can phone the landline and I'll leave a message saying who to contact as part of that, if you need to talk to anyone. Our thing is that in 2 weeks' time is communion here and at Arbuthnot, and then the following week at Gourdon at our mid-afternoon service. You're very welcome to join us at any of these, or indeed all of these if you wished, services together as we share in the Lord's Supper on the 5th of December here and at Arbuthnot, and on the 12th at Gourdon. The other thing I want to say was a few weeks ago we had our celebration service where we gave thanks to God for the people who serve our church. Primarily we were giving thanks to those who'd served for a long time and for our guild organisations, but also as part of that we were giving thanks and responding to God in generosity as part of the Church of Scotland's National Giving Day. And we encourage you to give generously if you could, and as part of that I got some yesterday. It's not been totally finalised yet, but once include gifted, over £9,000 was raised. So thank you to those who gave, whether you gave as normal and put your normal collection in the plate, or you gave more than you would normally give, thank you so much. It's about £6,500 that folk gave, plus gifted, takes up to around £9,000. And still got to finalise the figures, but around that kind of sum. So thank you so much. But let me encourage you to keep on giving. We've for many years been a kind of just touch and go in terms of our budget each year. And it's now nice to have a little bit of leeway. So don't just go, well, I don't have to give now for the next 6 months, otherwise we'll be back down into debt. So please keep on giving, and thank you for your continued generosity. I think it's all the notices for now. Or I'm off next week, but Andrew and Margaret will be leading worship here together. We're going to open up as a call to worship, and as part of that, what I'm going to do is read some of the words from Psalm 96, and at the end of each paragraph, I'm going to say the words, O people of God, and you can respond, give the Lord glory and honour. So I'll say a paragraph finalised by, O people of God, you respond, give the Lord glory and honour. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Tell his glory among the nations, among his peoples, his wondrous deeds. O people of God, give the Lord glory and honour. For great is the Lord and highly to be praised. Awesome is he beyond all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but our Lord made the heavens. O people of God, give the Lord glory and honour. Give to the Lord, all you nations. Give to the Lord glory and praise. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring yourself and enter his presence. O people of God, give the Lord glory and honour. So let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the seas resound and let the fields celebrate. Let every part of creation burst with joy, for the Lord God is a glorious King of all. O people of God, give the Lord glory and honour. We are going to give this Lord glory and honour in our first couple of songs as we stand and sing together. God is for us, and then immortal, invisible, God only wise. If we're able, we'll stand to sing.
We won't fear the battle, we won't fear the night. We will walk the valley with you by our side. You will go before us, you will lead the way. We have found a refuge, only you can say. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, the
Thank you.
Let us pray. We'll close with the words of the Lord's Prayer on the screens. Let us pray. Immortal, invisible God, only wise. Father God, we thank you for all of your power, your glory, your wisdom, and your might. We give you praise that you are our Creator, the perfect, eternal, glorious one who cannot tolerate sin or evil. And yet, by your nature, you're a Redeemer and a Savior. You've come to save us. You came into our world as a perfect King of glory, taking upon human flesh, living a perfect life, dying as a substitute for us. And now you're raised from the dead, ascended into heaven, interceding and praying for your people who you chose before the foundation of the world. Glorious God, we are gathered this morning to worship you for all that you have done for us, to marvel in all that you are, to make much of the name of our God, to rejoice in your faithfulness, to marvel at your grace, to be in awe of your glory. God, we thank you for the privilege it is to be your people and to worship you here as we gather across different generations, different backgrounds, different circumstances. We come together as a people of Jesus, called out of darkness into your wonderful light. And this morning we pray that we might have eyes to see you for all that you are and all that you have done for us. For we come together as your people and we join our hearts and our lips in the words that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. We forgive those who sin against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We are going to turn to God's word now, and we turn to Isaiah chapter 43. If you've got a church Bible, a couple of folk have asked me recently, can you use a church Bible? Yes, you can. These days, and so if you want one, if you ever come here on a Sunday and you want one, just ask at the door and you're welcome to take one with you, or bring your own. I also encourage you to do that as well. But Isaiah chapter 43, reading the first seven verses. Kemba.
Good morning. So today's reading is on page 728 in the Pew Bible. Isaiah chapter 43, verses 1-7. But now, this is what the Lord says. He who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by my name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt for your ransom, Cush and Seba in your stead. Since you were pressured and honored in my sight, and because I love you, I will give men in exchange for you and people in exchange for your life. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. This is the word of the Lord.
Before we turn to that, one of my most favourite passages in Scripture, we are going to sing again, and we're going to sing together, Jesus, Be the Centre. You'll stand to sing. If there's a God, as I believe there is, and if that God rules the world as a supreme king over all creation and will bring the world and the whole universe to a close one day, as the Bible says that he will do, there are two important questions I think every human being on earth has to answer at one point in their life. But why did this God who rules over the world create me? And how do I live my life in alignment with the reason that he created me? What's God's purpose for me? What's his goal for me? And how do I bring my life in alignment with that goal? That's what we're going to look at this morning, based ourselves on that passage we just read from Isaiah chapter 43. Why did God create you? What's his purpose for you? And how do you live your life in accordance with that purpose? For every single one of your hopefully 70, 80, 90 plus years of life. And that's helpful too, is because we don't want to go through life kind of just aimlessly going, oh, I don't know what I'm supposed to do with my life. And nor do we want to make the wrong decision, thinking, oh, it's about doing this. And finding out God says, no, it was never about that. It was about this instead. So we read from Isaiah chapter 43, or Kemba did for us this morning. And Isaiah is a prophet from God, called to spend his time passing on the message of God to the people of God. And actually, we find the answer to our questions this morning in the final verse, in verse 7. But before we get to that, let me give you a little bit of context about what we just read from Isaiah chapter 43. The words are up here. I'll read it again. But now this is what the Lord says. He created you, Jacob. He who formed you, Israel. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt for your ransom, Cush and Seba in your stead. Since you are precious and honored in my sight, And because I love you, I will give nations in exchange for you, nations in exchange for your life. So do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them all up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar, my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. In those verses, in verses 1 and 5, we saw these words, do not fear. And the reason that God says that, and he gives a little explanation as to why we shouldn't fear, and he says, look at what I've done for you in the past. It proves my love for you and my care for you, so you need not fear. He says, I have redeemed you. In other words, I took you out of slavery in Egypt. And remember, the people of God, at the end of Genesis, find themselves happily in Egypt. But then we've turned the page into the book of Exodus and we find themselves that they've been there for many hundreds of years and they're now slaves to the Pharaoh and the Egyptian people. But God, as we read in the book of Exodus, takes them out through the Red Sea, keeps them safe, and the people are set free. So God says, I called you, I picked you out of all the nations of the world, and I set you free. You are my people. And so you can count on me when the deep waters come flooding your way again, when the raging fire comes sweeping over you, I will be with you. Do not fear. You are precious to me. Do not fear. So that's the first argument why people shouldn't fear. God has been with them in the past. But then God says in verse 5 again, do not fear. And a new argument is offered in these closing verses. What is it that propels God to keep his people safe and help them? Verse 4 says, you're precious in my sight and I love you. And then in verse 7, that we're going to bed down today, he says this, I created you for my glory. The second last line there. He says, I planned you, conceived you, formed you, and achieved your creation, and by doing so, I receive glory for my name. And what God is saying there is, do not fear, because I made you, and I love you, and I made you for a purpose. Something so much bigger than you could ever dream of. You're not pointless, you're not an accident. Doesn't matter the circumstances of your conception, you were never an accident. I made you. I planned you, I love you, I have a purpose for you. Do not fear, for you're created for my glory. So humanity are made to give glory to God, and you might wonder, well, what does that mean? What is the glory of God? What do we mean by this term, glory? Well, it's actually close to impossible to describe. I say that because the word glory is more like the word beauty than the word pencil. For instance, if someone came up to you and they'd never heard of a pencil, never seen a pencil, and they said, what's a pencil? You could say to them, well, it's a small, thin bit of wood that's pointed at one end, and in the middle of it, down the middle of it, there's a bit of graphite that when you push down on a bit of paper, it makes a mark on it. And if you move your hand in certain ways, it creates the letters or numbers or words or pictures on the paper. And if you described it well enough, they could go to a shop or go to your jumbled up drawer like we've got in our house, and they could say, that's what a pencil is. I understand it because I've seen it and you've described it well to me. But if someone came up to you and said, define beauty for me, how would you go about that? How would you define the word beauty? Now, you could tell me what is beautiful. You could say, oh, my children or my grandchildren or my nieces or my nephews. Or you might say that, look at the landscape, it's beautiful. But, well, the landscape doesn't look like your nephew or your niece or your grandchild, so you can't say that your nephew and niece is a tree or a hill or a sunset. So what is beautiful? And that's kind of like that with the word glory. You can't describe it by what you see, but you can by what you see. If you point at enough things, you can say, that's beauty, and that's beautiful, and then folk can get a picture of what it is to be beautiful or to see beauty. And it's like that with the word glory. But let me give you a try and a stab at what glory is. The glory of God is the infinite beauty and greatness of all of God's perfections, because he is abundantly loving, supremely just, infinitely holy, outstandingly gracious, perfectly wise, absolutely faithful, eternally good, unchangeably merciful, extraordinarily powerful, and so much more. And when you begin to see these things and you read them in the scriptures and we sing about them on Sunday, and you get a little bit of a grasp at what these things are, you can see them and savor them, and you can rejoice in the treasure that God is. And then you can say, that's what glory is. That's glorious. When I meditate on who God is and what he's done for me, and I see all that and I understand some of it, that's what glory is. Because when God puts himself on display and the people apprehend that, they can give him glory. So what does it mean to give God glory? Well, it's to make much of this God who is all of these things. It's to delight in all that God is. It's to see God for who he is and to say, I want to make him king over all of me. To glorify God means to acknowledge his greatness and his supremacy in all parts of our life by praising him and worshiping him, because he and he alone deserves to be worshipped and praised like no one else. Of course, we can celebrate people and say thank you to people, as we rightfully should do, but God is so much bigger than all of those people. God is glorious, and when we recognize that and say, God is glorious, and when we say, I want to live my life in alignment with that, then you glorify him. So friends, I want you, because I care about you and I love you, not to waste your life. Whether you're nearing the end of your life, or whether you might think you've got another 500 decades left of life on this earth, I want you to live the life that God calls you to. And your life, God says, is to give glory to him. That's what he says in verse 7. I created you to give me glory. Those people that I formed and made, all of us, I created you to give me glory. Now, you might not recognize that, you might not like that, but that's why you were made. And so I don't want you to waste your life choosing something else or going another way. Because our lives are wasted here on earth if we live the way that someone else or something else tells us to. The world might say the best thing you could do with your life is be successful. Get as many friends as you can. Earn as much money as you can. Just make sure that your children and your grandchildren achieve lots. That's what life is all about. Now, those things are great and good, that's fine, but that's not what God says life is all about. Lives are wasted when we make it all about us and our achievements and what we have done on earth. When we waste our lives when we make ourselves the all-encompassing focus. We waste our lives when we don't dream and think and pray towards God being great and glorious in our life, in all of our life. If you were to ask people in the world today, out there in Bervie this morning, they might say that, yeah, I think God exists, but to me, he exists just like a star in the night sky. In other words, he's a tiny little speck in the night sky, a tiny bit of light that, well, I see him, but I don't need to do anything with him. He's not that big. He's not that important. You can cover him up if you can cover a star up if you put your thumb out like that, and you can cover up thousands of stars because they're just a tiny speck in the night sky. But you and I know that that tiny little speck of light that you see is not a tiny speck of light. If you were to go and get in a spaceship for hundreds or thousands of years, you would see that the stars that are just specks of dust in the night sky are humongous, millions of times bigger than our planet. And that's what it means to glorify God. Not to see him as a tiny speck of dust in the night sky, but to see him for what he really is. Not a tiny little thing, but a great, magnificent, glorious king overall. And so when we first hear that, you might think, well, that's not very loving at all. People don't feel very loved when they're told your purpose is not about yourself, but it's all about God and giving him glory. I feel used. I don't want to do that. I want to live for myself. It's not about God. It's about me. But I can understand that because of the way the world thinks of what love is, particularly in recent generations, but I think it's always been the case, that folk feel that love is just making much of them. It's all about boosting someone's ego, making someone else feel good about themselves and their own decisions. But that's not what the Bible says about love. Love, described in the Bible, is about doing what's best for someone else. So love isn't always about boosting someone's ego or doing what they want all the time. For instance, if any of you ever have seen or heard a child, you'll have been in the shops and you'll seen a child one day or another having a temper tantrum in the sweetie aisle or in the cereal aisle. Why? Because they want 55 boxes of Nesquik or 500 boxes and bags of sweets. Now, hopefully, most of you were good parents or looked after kids well, and you didn't say, fine, we'll fill up the shopping trolley only with Nesquik or other chocolatey cereal, or we'll only give you sweets and biscuits for the rest of your life. Because you love that child, you say no, or you only give them maybe one box or one bag of sweets. Because I love you, I don't want your teeth to rot. I don't want you to be 86 stone by the time you're 4 years old. And so I'm not going to give in to what you want, what your ego says is good. We notice this with Asher. Sometimes he's coming into the kitchen as one of us is cooking something in the oven, and he likes to play with the oven door. And so he comes in, and we're standing at the oven, and he's like, ah, what's in here? And because we love him, we yank his arm, and it hurts him probably at times when we're being so close to him, pulling open the oven and putting his hand in it as it's blazing furnace. But because we love him, we pull him away and we say, no, we don't want you to do whatever you think is good for yourself. Because we love you, we might have to do something that upsets you in the process. And so that's kind of what it's like here. That when we make ourselves the kings and queens, when we say, no, I want to get into the oven, I want to eat all the sweets, when we make ourselves the object of our highest affections, we choose second best. But when this all-powerful, supremely radiant, beautifully gracious God puts himself on display and says, worship me instead, look at me instead, that is the most loving thing that God could do. By pointing to himself and prompting everyone in humanity to worship him, then that is actually love. Let me explain. We were made to enjoy God. All of us, yourself, your spouse, your children, your nieces and nephews, your friends, your neighbors, your colleagues, your enemies, everyone who lives in Bervie and beyond, were made to see and savor God. We were made to relish in all that he has done and find ourselves enjoying God's presence and being satisfied in the process. And it's only when we fix our eyes on Jesus, rather than the person in the mirror in the morning, only then will we find supreme joy and supreme satisfaction for this life. John Piper, a famous pastor and theologian and writer, wrote a book, I think before I was born, called Desiring God. And in that book, he came up with this term, Christian hedonism. And what he says is that basically God's ultimate goal in the world and our greatest desire are actually the same thing. What he's saying is that God's ultimate goal for all of humanity or for all of the world is to give him glory. But when you ask people, what's your greatest desire in the world? They will say, I want to be happy in this life. I want to be happy. And I'm sure that's your goal in this life. I want to be happy in this life. And John Piper says, well, actually, they're the same thing. Because when God is glorified, humanity are satisfied. He says this, God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. What does it mean? Well, he says that when you glorify God, when you give God your all, because he is perfect and glorious and all that he is, and he's perfect in all of these things, then you can't be any more satisfied than finding your life in his life. And so God's glorified in that process. And because God is perfect and wonderful, you find supreme satisfaction. Why? Because, well, in this life, all the things that might give us some joy don't last forever. So those bags of sweets or the cereal that's sugary, it's great, but it doesn't give you joy forever. Or the job that you have and you loved, well, one day you might find that the economy collapses and your job doesn't exist anymore, or you retire from that work, or you get injured and you can no longer do it, or your spouse or your family or your friends, you might fall out with them. They cannot give you perfect, wonderful joy forever, but God can. And so when you find your life walking with his life, then you can find complete and utter joy. Why do you exist? To glorify God by enjoying him. Don't let anyone ever tell you that Christianity, that following Jesus, is just a bunch of rules that are basically don't do this, don't do this, and turn up on a Sunday morning. If they think that's all what following Jesus is about, they've missed the point. Following Jesus is about finding joy in him, about finding abounding volumes of joyousness and pleasure in God. As you increase your knowledge of God by reading the scriptures, as you walk in faithful obedience to him day after day, choosing what God calls you to live that way. And that's not the only, and this is all throughout the Bible. John writes in John chapter 10, verse 10, he quotes Jesus saying, "I have come that people might have life and have it to the full." Jesus says, "I have come that people might have the real and eternal life, a life filled with abundance that's deeper and richer than they could ever imagine." In other words, when people follow me and choose me above all other things, then they have the rich, fulfilling, abundant, joyous life. And hundreds of years earlier, 1,000 years earlier, David, King David, wrote in the Psalms this: "You make known to me the path of life. You fill me with joy in your presence. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." You hear what he's saying? God, when I'm with you, when I put my faith and my trust and my life in you, as I walk with you day after day, then there is joy in your presence. And not just fleeting, passing moments of pleasure and joy, but pleasures forevermore, he says. And I find that in myself when I come to worship or in the rest of my life, not just in the Sunday mornings, but sometimes when I come here on a Sunday, I come not with the kind of abounding joy that I want to come with. Sometimes I come utterly shattered or just fed up or had a bad week, and I come because it's my job to do so and I've got to do something, otherwise you'll sack me. And so I've got to come up here, plan some songs we sing, do a few prayers, read a Bible passage and do a sermon. But I don't come with that abounding joy. But most of the time, I do come with that. And when I come with that feeling of, "God, I want to worship you this morning. I want my lungs to burst open because I'm so full of joy as I sing to you." And I want my prayers not to be words that I say, but prayers that come from the depth of my soul that these people can pray and believe will come true because we pray to a big God. When I come with that, then I leave here with abounding joy. And I feel so much more joyous than just turning up and going, "Oh, I've got to sing a few songs and do a few things for an hour on a Sunday morning." And maybe that's been your experience too. That when you come to God with that kind of sense of, "I want to worship you, God. I want to, tomorrow morning and Monday, live the life I'm supposed to live. So I'm not going to do the stuff you call me to not do. Because when I walk the right way, when I choose you first, there's joy in that moment. When I choose to sing, maybe raise your hands or just sing loudly and proudly, even if you cannot sing, then it's so much better because now I know real eternal joy. And again, because I love you and I care for you, I want you to have a joyous life. Not based on how many friends you have, not based on what job you have, not based on how many pounds are in your bank account, but on God himself, because he's the one who can give you real and everlasting joy. So if you want to live the life that you're called to live, glorify God. Do you want to enjoy life and enjoy it abundantly? Then seek to make much of your Lord and King. Infinite joy, outrageous joy is offered to you. Take it and grasp hold of it. It's yours when you fix your eyes on your Savior and your God. Make God your greatest treasure. Enjoy him as your greatest pleasure. Enjoy God and glorify him forever. Let's pray. Father, how marvelous it is that you are this amazing, outrageously huge, abundantly merciful, supremely just God who's holy. And despite all of those things, you call us to know you and to worship you and find life in your name. God, we pray this morning that we might be a people who enjoy your presence. Not put up with it for an hour on a Sunday morning, but enjoy your presence in all parts of our life by choosing you first, walking your way. God, help us this morning if we've come here today not feeling particularly joyous, not particularly keen to worship you. May you open our hearts and our eyes to see you for all that you are and all that you've done for us, that we might glorify you by enjoying you forever. Lord, bless us in this, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Tom's going to come up and he's going to lead us in a time of prayer as we pray for our world and our wider community.
Good morning, everyone. Let's bring our prayers for others before our loving Father God. When I say the words, Lord, in your mercy, I invite you to respond with the request, hear our prayers. As we look around at all the people who share life with us in your world, Lord, we are blessed when we see inspiring examples of lives devoted to you and the care and well-being of others. Alas, we also see lives that are distorted by sin, and many lives that are burdened by the sins of others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for all in positions of power and influence, those in government, defence, civilian authority, justice, health, education, commerce, science, food production, transport, media, and the arts. May they know you and your purposes for their duty of service to those for whom they are responsible. We pray for those who are charged with the manufacture and supply of goods and the delivery of services. May they be glad to serve you and their fellow human beings. We pray for all who receive services and leadership. May what they receive be good in your eyes. May they respect those who serve them and recognize that your bounty is for all your people here on earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. As well as praying for others, Lord, help us to pray for ourselves. Open our eyes and ears to your answers to prayer. It's easy to think and say good words about situations that concern us, then to stand back, detached and idle in our own comfort zones. Usually, you have parts for us to play in your plans. Give us the ability to discern and the courage to actively respond to your calls, especially when we find them challenging. When we pray for the lonely, help us to seek out one or more lonely person and offer them our kindness and fellowship in the name of Jesus. When we pray for the hungry, help us to share our provisions with one or more hungry person in the name of Jesus. When we pray for the destitute, help us to share our resources with one or more needy person in the name of your Son Jesus, whom you sent into this world as a living example for us and our supreme Savior from sin. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. O God, may we all learn to lead our lives lovingly in service to you and the caring service of our fellow human beings, respectful of your world around us, and always for your glory. Amen.
I'm going to close in song in a moment, but I should have said earlier that next week, as I say, I'm off next Sunday, and Andrew and Margaret are leading it, but next Sunday we start Advent. Advent is a four-week period leading up to Christmas. It doesn't begin on December the 1st when you open your first chocolate. It begins the four Sundays before, which this month it'd be November the 28th. So next Sunday, Andrew and Margaret are going to be thinking about topic, and we're calling it our series in Advent, the Christmas wish list, thinking about what are the things that we want in our lives. We're thinking this morning about joy, in particular, I guess. What do we want in our life? And these are the same things that actually Jesus, the one who's come to save us, brings to our world. So I encourage you to come along to that over the next 4 weeks and think about what is God giving to us this Christmas. But we sing our closing song this morning. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. So may you be lost in the love of God as you praise your Saviour all day long. May the blessing of God be with you and all who you love today and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Please take a seat and I'll see you as you go this morning.